Good morning. In the last class, we discussed about the basics of convolutional codes, how they are different from block codes, how to find a code word using three different methods in a convolutional code, and also how to draw the encoder circuit of a convolutional code. Let's take some one or two examples to further clarify our concepts. So let's move on to the second example. Here, draw the convolutional encoder for rate half and constraint length 1, given the data sequence is 10101. Find the convolutional code using all three methods in the time domain. Let G1, the generator 1 be 11 and generator 2 be 10. Draw the encoder. So first we have to draw the block diagram of the encoder. Let's try to find N, K and M first. It would be easy for us. N, K and M values we have to find. Rate is given, the code rate is given as half. Therefore, if rate is half, this is nothing but K by N. Yes or no? The code rate is defined as K by N, which means K is equal to 1 and N is equal to 2. So we directly got the values of K and N because the rate value was given. They have also given the constraint length as 1, which means this capital K or small m is 1. So either this K or M is 1. So the number of memory elements or flip-flops in the shift register is 1. Now, I have the N, K, M values. It is a 2-1-1 convolutional encoder. We have to try to draw the block diagram for this encoder. So whenever we have to draw the block diagram for that, please understand. So since there are two bits in the output code word, I have to have a switch making two connections, an SPDT switch or a commutator which can make one of the two connections, C1 or C2, to get a code word of 2. Usually we will have both these connected to 2 modulo 2 adders, but sometimes it may not be required. It depends on the generator sequence. Let's see. And the input data bit is a 1, okay, and 1 memory element. Therefore, your circuit looks something like this. One single memory element you should draw first. The input data which comes to this one memory element should be a single line indicating K value is 1. And initially we have written 2 modulo 2 adders for N being 2. For the code bits being 2, we have written 2 modulo 2 adders. But you can see here, the inputs to the modulo 2 adders should be based on these generator sequences. G1 is 11, which means I should consider this point before the flip-flop and this point after the flip-flop. Both should be fed to this upper modulo 2 adder to give you the code bit C1 of 1. Similarly, for the lower modulo 2 adder, I need to connect 10. In the sense, this bit and this bit need not be connected. In the sense, there is only one input to an adder, which means no addition is happening. Therefore, you can even remove this adder. This adder is not needed. You could directly connect this point to the final output bit, C2. So this is C1 and this is C2. You can name it anyhow. Usually we call it C1 like this and this is C2. Okay. Hence, the transmission line will make a connection either to C1 or to C2 and it will be sampling the bits at a quick rate. It will be changing the positions. So you can see the need for 2 modulo 2 adders is eliminated in this circuit. So this is a simple way in which we can draw a convolutional encoder for the given specifications. Hope you understood this. Now we have to find the convolutional code, the encoded data in time domain, using three methods, for which let me first consider the given data. The given data is 10101, which means, so U or D, we call the data as U or D, which is 10101. Therefore, the number of bits, capital L, in the data is 5. And then we have the variable I in the summation ranging from 0 to M. Here M is 1. Because M is 1, I will range from 0 to 1. Okay. Next, the variable J, in that GI of J. Okay. J is for generator. It varies from 1 to N. So N is 2. So it varies from 1 to 2. Lastly, the other variable small l varies from 1 to capital L plus M. So capital L is 5 and M is 1. So it will vary from 1 to 6. If you make note of all these things, our computations become easy. So now we know the basic equation to compute is CL of J is equivalent to, this is the discrete convolution equation, summation I is equal to 0 to M UL minus I GI plus 1 of J. So instead of U, I can also say D. U or D is one and the same. Both represent the data. And GI plus 1 of J we have taken as before. Now we can go on varying this. So first let me find the code output of the upper modulo 2 adder CL of 1. So if I'm trying to define for CL of 1, I ranges from 0 to 1 because M is equal to 1. And DL minus I, GI plus 1 of 1. For J, I should take, because here the J value has been taken as 1. You see, this is CL of J. So since J value is taken as 1 here for the upper adder, this GI plus 1 of J, here I should take the upper generator sequence, G1. Okay. Now I'll compute the first code bit, C1 of 1. I'm varying L. L should vary from where to where. Small l will vary from 1 to 6. Therefore, first I'm taking L as 1, C1 of 1, the first code bit in the upper sequence. First term is D1 minus L minus I, D1 G1. Okay. And the second term is D, when I is 1, it becomes D0 G I plus 1. I plus 1 is 1 plus 1 G2 of 1. So this is the equation D1 G1 of 1 plus D0 G2. Why the second equation goes off? Because I don't have any data bit D0. The data bit which we have, the data which is given as 10101, will start with D1, D2, D3, D4, D5, or U1, U2 till U5, anything you can name it as. Okay. So C1 of 1 will be D1, G1 of 1 plus D0, G2 of 1. D0 is doesn't exist, so it goes off. You just have to take which is the first data bit, D1. And what is the first generator bit? G of 1. What was the generator matrix? So given here, G of 1 was 1, 1, G of 2 is 10. So let's take the generator matrix. G of 1 is 1, 1. This is G1. This is G2, 1. Okay. So I am interested in G1 of 1. D1 is also 1. G1 is also 1. 1 into 1 is a 1, which gives you the end bit as 1. Likewise, C2 of 1, when L is equal to 2. Here, L is equal to 2, small l is equal to 1. if L is equal to 2, this becomes D L minus I. Start with I is equal to 0. 2 minus 0 D2 and GI plus 1, G1 of 1. Plus when I is equal to 1, 2 minus 1 becomes D1 and G of 1 plus 1 becomes G2. So we completed both the cases, D2, G1, D1, G2. All you need to do is substitute. What is D2? D2 is a 0. G1 of 1, whatever is G1 of 1, it doesn't matter. It's a 1. So 0 into 1 plus D1. How much is D1? 1. And what is G2 of 1? G2 of 1 is a 1. So I'll have 0 plus 1, which is a 1. Likewise, we'll go on finding all the data. As you can observe, for a given L value, you start with the same subscript for the data bit. So for finding C3, I'll start with D3. In the next bit, I'll have D2. In the next bit, D1. I need not write the bit with D0 because I know it doesn't exist. And likewise, for the generator, the highest data bit is accompanied with the first generator bit, G1 of 1. The next one is accompanied with G2 of 1. And the third one is accompanied with G3 of 1, so on. So you can see that given any data bit, okay, whatever you're given data bit, Cn of something, you'll start with the same, to find the code bit, you'll start with the same data value, but you always start with the first generator bit. Then you'll go on decrementing the data subscript and incrementing the generator subscript. So like this, you'll go on till you reach a point D1. Remember, I don't have values below D1, and by this time I would have reached GM plus 1. That is given number of memory elements plus 1. Okay, that will complete. This is how we can easily list using this discrete convolution. But I've already told you we need not do this. You can just consider the given data sequence. So what is the data sequence? 10101 and the given generator sequence. If you want to find the individual code bits, say to find C1, I'll consider only the generator sequence G1, which is 11. The generator sequence G1 is 11. So whenever it is a 1 here, list the bits. Whenever it is a 0, make one right shift and list zeros. Again, it is a 1, you list 11. It's a 0, you list 00. Finally, it's a 111. So at the end of this, I'll add up everything using modulo 2 addition. I have 1, 1 plus 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. So I'm going to get 6 ones as the code, and which you are going to get the same using this discrete convolution equation also. So you need not toil with this, but I've given you a general idea how you can write this basic equation and compute. So at the end of the multiplication of the first generator sequence with the data, I'm going to get the first code bit output as all ones, as shown here. Okay. Likewise, if we want to do the multiplication of the given data with the second data sequence, so second generator sequence, 10101, I am supposed to get the code sequence for the second modulo 2 adder. The generator sequence for this modulo 2 adder was 10, I think, right? Yeah, the generator sequence is 10. So let me consider that generator sequence. It's a 1, keep the generator. It's a 0, keep zeros, but keep shifting right always. It's a 1 again, so 10 should be kept. It's a 0, nothing should be kept. It's a 1, 10 should be kept. So at the end of this, we'll add all the bits using modulo 2 addition 101010. So this is the code bit C2. Now we have C1 as 111111 and C2 as 101010. Therefore, what is the overall C, the code? I told you we can also call it as V. V or C both mean one and the same. The overall code bits would be interlacing these two or interleaving first bit of this, first bit of this. 1, 1. Second bit of this, second bit of C2. 1, 0. Third bit of C1, third bit of C2. 1, 1. Fourth bit of each, 1, 0. Fifth bit of each, 1, 1. Sixth bit of each, 1, 0. Therefore, if I write the complete code vector V or C, I'm going to get 111010111010. This is the first and second method of finding the convolutional code in time domain. The first method is to simply use the equation. The second method is to use this tabular format. See, the second method. And if I want to get the code directly with one step, I can interleave the generator bits. G1 was 11, the generator G2 was 10. So the overall generator G can be obtained by interleaving the first and first bits of G1 and G2, the second bits of both. So I'll get the interleaved generator as 1110. Now you consider the data sequence and go on doing this tabular method. It's a 1, 1110 should be retained. It's a 0, then nothing should be retained. After interlacing, please remember you should do the shift of 2 bits. Why? Because I have interlaced 2 generator sequences and it's not a single sequence now. So you surely have to leave or do a right shift of 2 bits. The third bit is a 1, again right shift twice and retain all the 4 generator bits, 1110. Fourth bit is a 0, so all zeros. Fifth bit is a 1, so 1110. Hence, the convolutional code, the final code, we get it directly 11101110110, which is same as the previous case, you can see. Okay, this is method 2. Now coming on to method 3. In method 3, we are going to write the generator matrix. Remember, how do we write the generator matrix? I have to consider G1 of 1 and G1 of 2. G1, G2. So I'll have to consider G1 of 2 and G2 of 1, G2 of 2. Likewise, I can go on considering G1 R. The first generator, G2 are the second generator bits. So if I try to write the generator matrix according to this, I'll have to include zeros. Then I have to go on shifting. Let's try to do this. G1, first bit of this and first bit of this interlaced, it will be 11. The second bit and second bit interlaced, 10. But you have to try to find what would be the total number of columns and total number of rows. Remember, the generator matrix has L rows into N into L plus M columns. How much is L? The given data has 5 bits. So I have to have 5 rows, and N, the code bit, has 2 bits per message. Capital L is 5, small m is 1. So totally I should have 5 into 2 into 6, 12 columns, right? Now we have only 4 columns with the given data. So I have to insert zeros in the remaining 8 positions. So totally 8 plus 4, 12. Next row, if I have to write, I just have to shift right by 2 bits, 1110, and again fill up the rest with zeros. The third row, I have to shift right again by 2 bits, 0000. Fourth row, again you shift right by 2 bits, 111000. And last row, you'll end up shifting right by 2 bits and 1110 in the last position. What we started off in the leftmost or beginning, we should get it in the last position. The same thing is written here. That's how you write the G matrix, the generator matrix. Now, you just have to do a multiplication, matrix multiplication. This is a 1x5 matrix and this is a 5x12 matrix. So I will end up with a 1x12 matrix, which would be the code matrix or the code vector V or C. You know how we should multiply. So multiplication yields this value. And if you observe, this is same as what we got in the previous two methods. The same answer we got in the previous two methods also. Okay. I hope the concept is clear. Now, let's go on to a little more complicated example where we'll take two input bits at a time. So, consider a 3-2-1 convolutional encoder as shown in this figure. Here, K is 2, which means the encoder consists of 2 M is equal to 1 stage shift registers. So, here the M value is 1, the K value is 2, N value is 3. Therefore, for every 2 input bits, I should get 3 code bits. For every 2 input bits, I should get 3 code bits. And every stage should have a 1 flip-flop shift register. Okay. Now, 2 stages are there. I should have 2 stages because I need to take in 2 input bits simultaneously. Therefore, I will have 2 1-bit shift register as shown here. And it's already given N is equal to 3. So there should be 3 code bits V1, V2, V3 or C1, C2, C3. And accordingly, 3 modulo 2 adders are there. In fact, I can use 6. But since I can use the same 3 for both data inputs, or they are working in serial order. So when the first bit comes, I'll compute the, I'll use the modulo 2 adders for computation of the first sequence. When the second bit comes, for the second sequence. Remember, this happens at a very fast rate, which is not noticeable, but it can be done. With our present computing power, it could be done easily. 2 adders, 2 multiplexers are there. I have 1 input multiplexer here, where the data comes in serially and it gets split into 2 arms, the upper data arm U1 and the lower data arm U2. The second multiplexer is on the output side to take out the 3 code bits V1, V2, V3. The input data sequence enters the encoder 2 bits at a time and it can be written like this. So the first bit for the first sequence, they are interlaced again. I can either write sequence 1, U1 of 1, U2 of 1, sorry, it should be U2 of 1, U3 of 1, sequence 2, U1 of 2, U2 of 2, U3 of 2. So, there are 2 sequences. The upper sequence U1 has 3 bits. The lower sequence U2 also has 3 bits. But when we interleave them or interlace them, I'll take the first bit of this sequence and then the first bit of this. U1 of 1, U1 of 2. Second bit of this sequence, second bit of the second sequence. Likewise, third bit of both. This is how we can write the interleaved data. Okay. Usually, we'll consider the interleaved data to find the code. Now, you can see how this encoder circuit is drawn. This upper shift register is meant for the first input bit to generate the first set of code bits, and the lower shift register is meant for the second input bit, which will generate the next set of encoded bits. And we will have three generator sequences for each of them. For the upper one also, we'll have three generator sequences because I have three code bits and three modulo 2 adders. For the lower one also, we will have three generator sequences. Let's see how to write those generator sequences. So there are three generator sequences corresponding to each input sequence. Let's try to represent here. See, G1 of 1. So the first generator, which is for the first data sequence. For data sequence U1 of 1, okay, for U of 1, we are listing this generators. G1 of 1, for which I should consider this flip-flop. The upper flip-flop is considered for U of 1. The lower flip-flop is considered for U of 2. Now, you check which are the connections to the first modulo 2 adder. This is modulo 2 adder 1, 2, 3. The input side of this flip-flop is connected. The output side is also connected. It's a single flip-flop. So it's a 1 and a 1. I'll have generator sequence G1 of 1 as 1, 1. Okay. Similarly, the generator sequence here coming from this flip-flop, it's a 1 here, but from this end, there is no connection. So it's a 0 or 1, 0 I'm going to get for the second generator sequence, G1 of 2. The third generator sequence, G1 of 3 to this adder. Again, this input side is connected. The output side is not connected. So we'll have a 1, 0. Likewise, if you consider the second lower flip-flop, which corresponds to the data sequence U2. The data sequence U2, which is coming down, will be fed to the shift register having this flip-flop. Now, from this flip-flop, I should consider what are the inputs to the modulo 2 adders. We are sharing the adders. Okay. So look at the upper modulo 2 adder and check if there is any connection from the input side of this flip-flop. The input side of this flip-flop U2 is not connected to this, so it's a 0, whereas the output side is connected to both 1 and 2. It's a 1. Okay. Similarly, G2 of 2. For the second modulo 2 adder, you check the input and output sides of this flip-flop. Input side is also connected. Output side is also connected. So it's a 1-1. And finally, the last flip-flop for G2 of 3. The input side is not connected. The output side is also not connected. That means there is no connection to this adder. It's a 0-0. This is how you have to list the six generator sequences given. The input code enters at 2 bits per given unit of time. Now, how to write the encoding equations? Remember, individually, we can get the code bit V1 as what? Discrete convolution. U of 1. This part is G1 of 1. This part is G1 of what? This part will be G2 of 1. Since both are 1, the connection from here is also 1, connection from here is also 1. So what should I consider? I should consider this input, which is U of 1, the data convolved with this one, this generator sequence is there, G1 of 1, okay, plus U2, this U2 convolved with the second generator sequence G2 of 1. Because of these two generator sequences acting simultaneously, you have to take the given data input and convolve each generator sequence individually to the two data inputs. So the upper data input should be convolved with the upper generator sequence, and the lower data input U2 should be convolved with the lower generator sequence. Likewise, you'll find V2 also, U of 1 into G1 of 2, U of 2 into G2 of 2, and V3. All these equations you should be able to write. Let's try to compute the convolution operation directly. What I was telling you in the last slide itself, this V1 is after convolution, I can find this V1 of 1 or VL of 1. Let me take in general, this is L, VL of 1 as UL of 1, this data bit, and this data bit will be, what would this be? UL minus 1 of 1. See, I can write this as UL of 1. This can be written as UL minus 1 of 1 because it was sent in the previous time zone or the previous time period. And similarly here, we can write this as UL of 2 and this as UL of or UL minus 1 of 2. This is the upper data sequence. As you can see, U of 1, I am using L as the subscript because I'll use that as the variable to find the different code bits. Now, how do you find V of 1 or VL of 1? If I take the same subscript, it is the addition of UL of 1 coming here, UL minus 1 of 1 coming here, and finally UL minus 1 of 2. You can see it is the sum of these three values. Okay. If we are able to write these equations, it becomes quite simple. Similarly, this VL of 2, the second code bit, is also a combination of three values. This is from the upper one, I have UL of 1 coming here. Next, this we don't have. From the lower one, I have UL of 2 connected and UL minus 1 of 2. So we have all these three values. The last one, V3, is quite simple because I have only one connection here. That is UL. What is the connection? UL of 2 is connected. Okay. So you see, UL of 1 coming from here. This is only UL of 1 is connected to get VL of 3. I'm able to define the three code bits in the form of linear equations. And finally, the final code vector can be obtained by interleaving the different values of. So for each code vector, I'm going to get multiple bits, the first bit, second bit, so on. And each one I'll have the first, second, like this. I'll interleave the first of all three. See, V1 of 1, V1 of 2, V1 of 3. Then V2 of 1, V2 of 2, V2 of 3, V3, so on. Likewise, if you are able to interleave, you'll get the final answer. When we solve this using equations, it becomes much more simpler. You see here, you're going to get the data vector is given as 1110, 1110 after interleaving, because U of 1 is 101, the upper data vector, the lower one is 110. So when I interleave the respective bits, I'll get 1101, 1110, 1101, 1010. Okay. And the generator matrix is as shown. You can see 1110. 1110, 1010, and then we have 011100, G2 and G1. Observe the generator bits. So how do I get V of 1? It is u of 1 into g1 of 1 plus u of 2 into g2 of 1, right? Remember, this is how, u of 1 into g1 of 1 plus u of 2 into, rather than into, this is discrete convolution operation. U of 1 into g convolved with g1 of 1, u of 2 convolved with g2 of 1. So when we do this convolution, it's a simple discrete convolution. You have 1, 0, 1, and here, let me write it here, 1, 0, 1, and then on this side, what do I have? 1, 1. I have 1, 1. So 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1. This will result in 1, 1, 1, 1. One second. 1, 0, 1 convolved with 1, 1. Okay. Next, to this, what should I add? 1, 1, 0 convolved with 0, 1. 1, 1, 0 convolved with 0, 1. So I'll have 0, 1 because it's a 1, 0, 1, 0, 0. When I add up, I'll get 0, 1, 1, 0. Now I should add these two. 1, 1, 1, 1 plus 0, 1, 1, 0. If I add, I'm going to get 1, 0, 0, 1, which is what we have shown here. So I have just shown you the operation of the discrete convolution of 1, 0, 1 with the generator sequence G1 of 1, 1, 1. And the discrete convolution of the second input sequence 1, 1, 0 with G2 of 1, which is 0, 1, G2 of 1. And finally, we end up adding both with when we are going to get 1, 0, 0, 1. Likewise, you can do one more. V of 2 can be obtained as convolution of 1, 0, 1 with the sequence 1, 0, the second impulse response sequence. So 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0 would be the result. 1, 0, 1, 0, I will get. Similarly, what is the second data sequence? 1, 1, 0 convolved with 1, 1. What will you get? 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0. This will result in 1, 0, 1, 0. Now I should add 1, 0, 1, 0 plus 1, 0, 1, 0 gives you all four zeros, which is shown here. Likewise, you'll find V3. Now in the end, the final code vector V can be found by interleaving the first bits of all three. 1, 0, 1. So 1, 0, 1. 0, 0, 0. 0, 0, 0. 0, 0, 1. 0, 0, 1. 1, 0, 0. Hence, this would be the final code vector for the given data. Okay. And last, we'll see if I have to write the generator matrix. The third method is to write the generator matrix for this. You please observe, the first row will include the interleaved generator bits of the upper data sequence U1. This is for the upper data sequence U1. This will involve the interleaved generator bits for the second data sequence U2. That's all. And you go on shifting by 3 bits because n value is 3 in this. So let's try to write for this example. We have the interleaved data like this, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 0. We have interleaved U1 and U2. The generator bits are as shown, as you can see, G1, G2, G3. I'll write the first row by interleaving the upper, these G1 generator bits, G of 1 generator bits, 1, 1, 1. So the first row will have 1, 1, 1, then 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0. So I'm done with the first row. This corresponds to the input data sequence U1. The second row will compose of the second interleaved generator bits 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, then 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 0. So now I have written the interleaved generator sequences for both the input data sequences. All I have to do is shift. So I have to shift by 3 bits because n is equal to 3 here. So the first row is shifted by 3 bits. Then the second row is shifted by 3 bits. Third row is shifted by 3. So in general, this generator will have how many rows? Here the data bits are 6. Or if I consider one sequence has L rows, 3, two sequences will have 2 L rows. Totally 6 into n into what? L plus m. How many columns I should have? I should have 3 into what is L? 3 plus m is 1. So 3 into 4, 12 columns I'm supposed to have. In the sense, I should have another 6 more zeros here. Okay. So wherever we have left it blank, imagine or fill it up with zeros. That's how it is the generator matrix. You will have 2 L rows or 6 rows if I consider one sequence as 3. So 2 L is 6 rows and n into L plus m columns, 3 into 3 plus 1, 12 columns. This will be the generator matrix. And in the end, if you just multiply the given data vector with the generator. You just have to bring this U and multiply it with the generator. You'll get the code U into G, which will give you the values 101000001100 matrix multiplication. And you can verify this should be same as what we got in the last. See 101000001100. I should get the same answer when I do it using generator matrix also. See, both are same. So hence we have done two typical examples for convolutional encoding. We can also have another example of a 4, 3, 2 convolutional encoder in which the shift register lengths are 0, 1 and 2 as shown. You can observe here, we have the input data sequence split into 3 parts. So I have the upper sequence U1 going here, the second sequence U2 going in this line and U3 going in this line. So I have a switch or a commutator which will split the input data sequence into 3 parts. And if you notice the output side, there are 4 parts. I have 4 code bits or code sequences, V1, V2, V3, and V4. There are 4 code sequences formed. So I have a 4 segment commutator in this case. What does this mean? This means the input data sequence has 3 input lines, therefore K is 3, and the output bits per set of input bits. For every 3 input bits, we are going to get 4 output bits. That means N is 4, and the maximum number of flip-flops in any one sequence, say the highest number of flip-flops in any given sequence, for U3, we have 2 flip-flops. That's why the maximum number of memory elements or flip-flops M is 2 per line. Now, if I consider totally in this whole distribution, we have no memory elements in the upper data segment line. In the second data segment line, I have only 1 memory element. And in the third data segment line, I have 2 memory elements. Okay. So in the third segment line, I have 2. In the second segment line, 1. In the first segment line, none. Now, as you can see, there are only 3 modulo 2 adders, because if you notice, the first data segment is directly going as the output code bit. If you notice here, the first data segment U of 1 is directly connected to the code segment V of 1. Or in other words, V of 1 is equal to U of 1. There is no other modulo 2 adder or no input bits or input sequences to consider, no generator sequences for this. Whereas when we find the second modulo 2 adder V2, we will have to consider the modulo 2 adder here, this second modulo 2 adder. And I have to consider what are the inputs given to this modulo 2 adder. You can see it is U of 1. If I am going to consider the variable L, I can say UL of 1 because that line is directly connected. And here, what do I call this? I'll call this UL of 2. That is also connected. UL of 2. And the third input which is connected comes from this point, you can see. So if this point is UL of 3, this point will be UL minus 1 of 3, and this point will be UL minus 2 of 3. So since UL minus 1 of 3 is connected, I have to consider that as one of the inputs. And the last input which is coming is from here, which you can see. If this is UL of 2, this point would be UL minus 1 of 2. Therefore, it is UL minus 1 of 2. That is, for the second series of data input, I have both UL of 2 and UL minus 1 of 2, the delayed line version, both connected. In the third one, I have one of the inputs connected, right? So these would be listing V2. Likewise, we can list V3 and V4. Okay, I just wanted to show you this just to show how much the complicacy or the complications increase as we increase the number of data input bits in our example. So in the circuit, as the number of input data bits increase, the complication is much more higher. So third one, fourth one, we'll have all this defined. And similarly, for each one, we have a generator. Whereas for the second one, I have to define the generators. So you can see if I have to define the generator in the second one, I have to consider the output code bit here. What would it be? It would come from this point. So one, and from here it is connected. 1 1 would be what? It would be G1 2. 1 1 for the second generator. Then what would it, G2 of 2, what would I get output of the second modulo 2 adder? I would get the input of this line. I have to consider only the second data line. So the input of this line is not connected to this modulo 2 adder. Only the output is connected, right? So I have to write how much? 0, 1, then G3 of 1 here. It's quite difficult to monitor. In each case, for the second one, if I have to monitor, I will have to check out each line individually and I have to list the generator vectors. Okay. Likewise, even in the first one, though this goes directly, I have this input coming to the other three modulo 2 adders. So I will have to write the generator matrix even in the first case. We'll not go into so much of complications now. All I wanted to show you is how it looks and how complicated things can become. Okay, but even such things could be done easily by using software programs and hardware defined languages to hardware description languages to define all these circuits. Finally, each information bit remains in the encoder up to m plus 1 time units. because there are m memory elements, from starting from the input to the output, there it will remain for m plus 1 time units. And during each time unit, it can affect any of the n encoder outputs, which depends on the shift register connections. So we can say that the maximum number of encoder outputs that can be affected by a single information bit will be defined as NA. So total number of output or code bits which can be affected with a single message bit or a single data bit is N into M plus 1, approximately equal. Okay, it's not the exact value. And in many books, they'll call this as the constraint length also. Okay, we usually say the constraint length is nothing but the number of memory elements, but the number of code bits affected by a single data bit is also known as constraint length in some of the textbooks. So we'll keep this also in mind. For example, for all the encoders which we have studied, if we try to find the values of this constraint length, we would get 8, 6, 12 respectively. Okay, you can just go back and check out and see what would be the constraint length in each of the encoders which we have studied. Let's go through the first one. Here you see M is 3. So NA will be what? M plus 1 into N, which would be approximately 3 plus 1 into 2, which will give you 4 into 2 or 8. In this case, the constraint length for this encoder will be approximately 8. So this is how we have defined. Let's move on. Let's stop our analysis of the problem and let's move on to the next topic, that is transform domain approach to convolutional encoding, in the next class. Thank you.